Testing. Coming in now, a little louder. Okay, there we go. This is loud enough for this room. That's perfect. Thank you so much. The speakers have to put this microphone right on your lip.
Hold out here. It's useless.
Right here.
We told people 10:15, but I could make a couple of announcements before that. And we have one item of club business that we need a quorum, and we're at 16 and we need 18. So we'll see.
You do informational?
Yeah. Only information right now. My name is Carol Fuller. I'm president of this club, and I want to apologize if there's no regular club. I made a special trip to Costco yesterday and left it sitting on my kitchen counter. So have some decaf and tea and don't give me any grief. you know what the program is today, and I'll just tell you briefly that I took, you see, Ann López has a flyer out there called Farmworker Tours. I took that tour 3 months ago, and I was raised by an Okie father and an Arkansas mother. My dad worked in the fields till he was 16, said he never lived in a house till he was 16. And I thought I knew how bad their lives were. And it was pretty disheartening because, and Mike brought me home to tell you a little bit about this, but our great Democratic savior, FDR, in order to get the votes he needed at wartime, put into place regulations that really locked him out of a lot of labor protections that the rest of you enjoyed. For example, if you work, they work 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, they have Sunday off. As soon as they work Sunday, they become entitled to time and a half. You guys would be rioting in Sacramento if you had to wait till you were on your 70th hour before you were, 61st hour before you got time and a half. I understand, and we'll hear from Bill Monning, that is going to be changing, but they have not a lot of legal protections, and it's really legalized slavery. So next year is an election year, I don't need to tell you that, and we'll focus all our programs next year probably on, I don't know if you answered my email, Mike, I think we do Roe v. Wade brunch in January, and that's an annual event that's been going for a really long time. Last year, we usually have around 100 people. And last year, because of all the Trump election, we had 200 people. It was standing room only. About 40 people were standing in the back. And the next month, I asked Mike if he would be willing to do a kind of overview of all the congressional seats that the Democrats think they can flip and take control of Congress. In April, we will have an endorsement meeting. Two of our supervisors have to face re-election. There's some talk. I don't know if there's anything else really in June. Do you, Mike? I don't think so. In the fall are the really hard-fought council races, and I've heard talk of county and local ballot measures that might be up there. They're not confirmed at this point. One of them was on raising money for more affordable housing. I don't know if that will make it to our ballot. We have to qualify.
Rent control is possible.
Rent control is possible. So those are the kinds of things. So after our endorsement meeting in March. In August, we will have another endorsement meeting. As soon as the filings close in early August, we'll have an endorsement meeting for the council races, any ballot measures, school boards, and things like that. Last year we had to have, there were 10 Santa Cruz City Council races. There were so many candidates, we actually had to have a separate one for the school boards because there were so many school board candidates. So we usually only have one endorsement meeting, but last year we had that too. And we always need a quorum, so I'm appealing to all of you members to please get yourself to these meetings. Then, we just got a quorum, which is good. So, so I just at this point, and then Mike is going to take over. He's our program chair, Mike Rutkin, over here, member. Many years on the city council. Labor historian himself, So he's really well positioned on a lot of areas. But I want to just tell you that our next meeting is going to be really great at November 11th. John Laird and Mark Stone. John Laird is cabinet level position in the state, happens to live in Santa Cruz, Secretary of Natural Resources. And he is going to do he's a fabulous speaker. I'm sure many of you have seen him. He not only is thorough, has great history on all these issues, he's witty and he's succinct. He's really an excellent speaker. And he is going to do a roundup of the Trump rollbacks on clean air, clean water, climate change, and he's going to talk about the California state responses and the pushback from the state. And, you know, 1 in 8 people in the United States live in California. And I recently read that California is poised to passing Great Britain to become the 5th largest economy on the globe were we an independent nation. So you can imagine what we contribute to the U.S. economy. I don't know that number. But what we do here has tremendous resonance. You can't roll back Roe v. Wade while we are publicly funding abortions for low-income women in this state. So we're a significant player at all levels of government. So John Laird and Mark Stone will look at some of these pieces of legislation that are possible in the pushback have particular kinds of resonance here. Think of all the fire potential in these mountains. Just think of those kind of issues. So Mark is going to talk about the local aspects of the climate state actions. And then the other thing I want to mention to you is this Monday, day after tomorrow, John Chung, who is our California State Treasurer, candidate for governor, will be at the Democratic Party headquarters, 740 Front Street at 6:30. It'll probably be an hour event because he's rolling through everywhere he can hit. I have talked to a couple of local elected officials who know him and have heard him talk, and they've said he's excellent. He's an excellent speaker. He'd be an excellent governor. Those of you who see an occasional poll, he's polling behind Gavin Newsom, but there's something like 9 candidates. So the big hope is for his campaign is that, you know, we have a nonpartisan primary, so the top 2 voters, it could be 2 Democrats running against each other in November. So that's his goal. He lags behind Gavin Newsom on fundraising too, but he is one of the top 3, and I can never say the name, Bill, of the Los Angeles Villaraigosa.
Villaraigosa
is the 3rd one. So,
and Delaine Easton.
But she's polling pretty far behind them.
And she should not be ignored.
She is great. I actually gave her my endorsement. I said, you can have my endorsement. I'm president of the Women's Club. So, you did too, Coco. And Coco is chair of the Democratic Party. There you go. So, you know, we'll have some light appetizers and non-alcoholic drinks over at the John Chung event. But, you know, we're really small peanuts in a state with 39 million. We're about 260,000, I think. So to get high-level people, he could be our next governor through, is really something. So if you're curious and you want to hear him on a personal level, he's stumping, come on by. Okay? So that's...
When's the time and location for the Mark Stone?
November 11th.
Where?
United Methodist Church on California, it's 250 California. The parking is really good over there. It's not like trying to park downtown.
What time? Is that going to be in the fellowship hall of the church?
It's in the fellowship hall where the brunch is. It's 10 o'clock, the doors will open, 10:30, that program will start. So, without further ado, we do have this one item of business, members only can vote. The board has to appoint an audit committee annually to look at our books and make sure we're doing everything right. But you have to ratify, you have to approve our appointment. So the people who have done it several times are Carolyn Livingston, who is our membership chair, and is a fantastic data person, frankly. And assistant treasurer to the Democratic Party, too. And Madeline McCall over here, who is our bylaws maven, frankly, she knows, she's always correcting me. So it's not an election, Carol, we have to approve it. So I'm calling for somebody to make the motion to approve the appointment of Madeline. And, okay, Rose points and Mike second. So all members, put your hands up who support this. Elena, can you take Bill's a member.
Keep your hands up.
You put it way over, Bill.
Well, we've already counted members asked for the opposed, and we'll go the answer.
Yeah.
All right, all those opposed to appointing, objecting to them on moral turpitude grounds or something. Okay, my turn.
I don't know if you mentioned this or not, discussed it, but I guess there's a gubernatorial election in New Jersey.
No, we're not. We have a really, that's the other thing. At 11:30, Jimmy Panetta is coming. So we have to be out of here. So we're going to have Ann López for about 20 minutes, so, and then Bill, and then we'll have time for questions.
So we're really privileged today to have two speakers who really are experts on the question of farm labor. And they're coming from different experiences in this area, working with it stuff. So we're going to get, a good sense of what's really going on, both in terms of the daily life of farm workers, but also what's being done in terms of the state trying to respond to some of the concerns. As Carol mentioned, when FDR was president, they put together the National Labor Relations Act, which everybody's probably familiar with, which covers most labor and certainly all the private sector labor in the country. It doesn't cover all public employees. That's required other laws, sometimes state laws. But the national law that says there's an 8-hour day, a weekend, you know, things we're sort of assuming exist in the United States, they left out agricultural labor because the Dixiecrats, the Southern Democratic senators and Congress members, were not willing to support actually providing decent wages and working conditions for those folks. So it wasn't literally until Cesar Chavez and the United Farm Workers, there's some other small attempts. Filipinos earlier had tried organizing in California, had some success with it. In Florida, there had been some attempts at it, but it really wasn't until the United Farm Workers came along that we actually had a union that was directly addressing the concerns of farm labor. And so there's a California law that exists instead of an Agricultural Labor Relations Act at the federal level. We had to do it in California because we couldn't get one at the federal level. So our two speakers today, I'm going to talk to us. I should think about the slideshow first. This is a slideshow by David Baskin, who's David Bacon, who's an internationally known photojournalist. And he usually gives a talk along with the show and stuff. But we showed this show before in Watsonville. And I had it, and I asked him, and we paid him another $100 so we could show it again. And it gives you some idea that sort of just the images of what's going on. And so you're not going to get a talk along with it. We're going to turn it off when the speaker starts so you won't be distracted. But I think the work that he does, he has several different slideshows about international issues, farm labor, immigration issues, and things like that. And he's quite a public, gifted public speaker. So if you have other organizations you belong to, if you're looking for someone with a really good slideshow and talk to go along, you might think about engaging him, and you can contact me to find out his contact information. So our speakers today, first we're going to hear from Dr. Ann López. She works on a daily basis with farm workers in this county, and in terms of providing services, she's the executive director of the Farmworker Family Center, and they provide people with connections to food, healthcare, family needs, a whole long list of things. I'm sure she'll tell you more about them. But she's going to be happy to talk to you about what it's like to be a farm worker in San Francisco County, what they experience here, and what's going on. Our other speaker, I'll introduce them both now, is Bill Monning, our state senator. I first met Bill, actually, on the UFW picket line in Salinas during the great lettuce strike that was going on in 1970. And he was an attorney for the United Farm Workers. We all know that he's our state senator and really great on a whole wide range of issues, but he is a champion for farm workers in California from his own direct experience working with the organization in the past. And so we're going to hear a little bit more about what's the kind of legal framework that's going on here, what can be done about some of these issues, and I'll leave it to him to make clear what he thinks are the most important things we need to know about what we can possibly do as citizens in relation to this action. So let's start by welcoming Dr. Ann López.
Thank you so much, Michael. I appreciate it. And Carol, for inviting me to come and speak today. I'd like to start out with a context, and that is I've worked with farm workers now for 20 years. I studied the impact of NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, on farm workers and their families in Mexico for my research. And after work, and at that time when I was doing the research, there was just nothing. No, there was no news, there were no books, there was nothing. And so the hope is that now that there's sort of a resurgence in concern about their lives, then things might change for the better. But on that positive note, I'll give you the context that I've been left with after 20 years. And that is that slavery is not dead. We have it right here, just a few miles away. And rather than the South, the Southern model of a white owner owning black bodies, what we have here are laws, institutions, rules, and regulations that keep people trapped and from which escape is nearly impossible. So I'll outline a few of those, even though my time is limited. But I think it's something that is a blight in the county and in the state and needs to be rectified. There are viable solutions that we all can participate in. So it's not like a hopeless case, but to think that slavery is over, is I don't think that's accurate from what I've observed. So I'll start by saying that the latest figure I've heard is that there's about 21,000 farm workers in our county, and about 83% of those are undocumented. Now, they don't come here to break our immigration laws. We set up the North American Free Trade Agreement and literally destroyed the rural economy of Mexico. So in order to survive, they have to come here to work and send money home to their families. That is the origin of the undocumented population. Now, they live, and I think that this probably explains the rest of their lives, the fact that they live in grinding poverty. It's poverty that I have not seen anywhere else, really, at least in this state. And they make around, depending on the farm worker, between $13,000 and $17,500 a year in Santa Cruz County. And their salaries don't often pay the rent. So the way that they handle paying rent and having a roof over their head is that they double up, triple up, quadruple up. I have one Oaxacan family that manages one of our three sheds in the county, and there are 17 people living in less than 1,000 square feet with one bathroom. That's the kind of living experience that they have. One of the women that I work with is a single mother of four children and one grandbaby. She works 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, bent over in the fields. And again, her salary does not cover the rent. So she has to do other things, rent out a room in her house or whatever. Rarely do you find a farm worker family on its own living in their own dwelling. Usually they're just very crowded households. Now, with a very low salary, they have a very poor diet, and they cannot afford to buy the produce, the fruits, vegetables, and nuts that they harvest. So they focus mostly on carbohydrates and cheap kind of junk food. And I know that if you go down to Riverside Drive and go up Riverside toward Watsonville, you'll see a McDonald's on the left and a Burger King on the right. And many of them, because they're exhausted and poor, depend on those two institutions for their food supply. Diabetes, high cholesterol are rampant in the farm worker population. And related to diet, I last winter, with all the heavy rains, when I visited farm workers, I noticed that there seemed to be less and less food in the house. And one time I visited, and the two little girls in the family were asking for food, And the mom just ignored them. And I said, we'll give them something to eat. And she kind of looked away. And then on instinct, I went and opened their refrigerator. This was in February. There was a third a gallon of milk, one head of lettuce, and two small Jell-O cups. That was all that was in the refrigerator. And I asked her, I said, where's your food? She says, we have no work. We can't, we have no money to buy food. And they don't want to go out because they're all undocumented and afraid of being nabbed by ICE. So they'd rather stay in their apartments and starve than risk deportation. I asked how extensive this was. She said the whole Oaxacan community is hungry. So we, the Cobb director and I called the food bank and told them the situation. And they were so kind, that very afternoon they brought out food for 133 families. Isn't that fabulous? We should be very proud of that. So no one had to starve, and from that point on, they kept delivering food every week during that very difficult period when there was no work. They obviously suffer from overwork. They are exempt from the Fair Labor Standards Act, the National Labor Relations Act. What governs their lives is called agricultural exceptionalism. And as far as the actual enforcement of whatever laws exist, there's just none. And so they're all overworked. The women have it the worst. There's two studies, one from UCLA and one from the Southern Poverty Law Center, about women farm workers. And 60 to 80% of these women in the fields are sexually harassed, groped, or outright raped in the field. And some of the women have to engage in sexual activity with the grower in order to be hired for the job. So there's, you know, it's just very grim. There's no health insurance, or if there is, it's minimal. I spent quite a bit of time trying to find where I could get health insurance for farm workers. And then they are the most exposed population to pesticides. And in the Salinas Valley here now, how many of you have heard of Flint, Michigan and the environmental racism there? How about the Standing Rock Sioux and the Dakota Pipeline? How many of you have heard about chlorpyrifos and organophosphates in the Salinas Valley? Usually not as many, and those are right down the road from us. The Chamacos Berkeley scientists have done a study that shows that for every 522 pounds of organophosphate pesticides a pregnant woman is exposed to, within a kilometer, her child, her fetus, by the time it's seven, will have lost 2.2 points of IQ. And some of the women in the Salinas Valley, most of whom are Latino or Latina, are exposed to thousands of pounds of organophosphate pesticides. Then their fetuses, who are already intellectually deficient, go to the surrounding schools, and chlorpyrifos, which is an insecticide a neurotoxin left over from World War II, is drift prone. It moves through the fields once it's sprayed into the classrooms and interferes with the normal development of the brain and spinal cord of these children. Now, this is disgraceful. I mean, we're working with Californians for Pesticide Reform to get chlorpyrifos banned from the state. It's too dangerous. The EPA was due to ban it on March 31st of this year, and then Scott Pruitt got together with the Dow executives and reversed the ban. So it's still perfectly all right to gas Latino children with chlorpyrifos and interfere with their brains. Now, what are these kids going to do when they grow up? They can't think. They're intellectually deficient. So this will guarantee the next generation of farm workers. And another rule or regulation is the 50-mile regulation in the migrant camps that we're working to modify at the least, which says that there's 24 migrant camps. They provide clean, affordable housing, one of the few clean, affordable housing options for farm workers. But the problem is that the requirement is if you live in the camp, once November 28th comes around, you have to move at least 50 miles away if you want to come back the following year. Now, all the people in the Buena Vista migrant camp here, which we visit on the Farmworker Reality Tours, all of those people have children. And so those children have to go to a minimum of 2 schools every year. They fall further and further behind. They eventually drop out, thus guaranteeing the next generation of farm workers. There, in the 20 years I've been visiting families there, I have not heard of one single high school graduation. So these children are essentially blocked from developing themselves intellectually. And to me, this is very sad because every parent I've ever talked to, their goal and what gets them in the field in the morning at 5 o'clock is that their children will become educated and out of farm work. So now we've set up chlorpyrifos and the 50-mile regulation, which makes that dream impossible. I think it's very cruel.
And so with exposure to pesticides and so on, the average life expectancy of a farm worker in this county is 49 years.
Poor diet, exposure to pesticides, and usually they die from some bone-related cancer, which is consistent with exposure to pesticides. Now, farmworker families are under assault. I just wrote an article about this. First of all, with NAFTA. NAFTA forced families in Mexico to separate by sending mostly the adult males to the United States to work in the fields and send money home. So that's the first separation. Then we have the 50-mile regulation. If you're a parent and want your kids educated and you live in the migrant camp, you have to send your children away to live with somebody who's going to have consistent education available for the entire year. And some of these parents in the migrant camp are so committed to their children's education, they do this. And they always tell me, I really miss my daughter. She's in Shafter this year. Or I really miss my son or whoever. And so they, again, another separation, splitting up the family. Lately, because of Trump's edicts, we now have the DACA students, many of whom became DACA students as a result of NAFTA. And now they're threatened with deportation, which again will separate another family member. And then finally, there's the ever presence of ICE. And luckily we have SB 54, which has made all of California a sanctuary state, but it's no guarantee. So to live with those four attacks on your potential attacks on your family. I don't know of any other family type in the United States that's under that kind of threat. Does anyone else? If you do, I'd like to know about it. Now, to conclude, farm workers need 4 things. First of all, they need to know their work is appreciated, and they don't think that. Because of the poverty and the low pay, they just figure, people, they're just grunt machines in the farming system. They need comprehensive immigration reform. Nobody who's bent over in the field 10 hours a day for 2 years should be worried about deportation, for goodness sakes. Who's doing who the favor? I don't want to get out there and be bent over in the field picking berries.
we're very lucky to have them. And California and Mexico are in an interdependent, irreversible binational system of production and reproduction. Reproduction of farm workers in Mexico, production of capital in farming systems here. And we need to adjust our system so that these human beings are not treated as implements of a farming system, but are actually acknowledged for the full human capacity that they have. They need a living wage, a living wage. And I'm happy to hear Bill just told me that a minimum wage is coming for farm workers in 2020. Or
it's already graduating up to $15 an hour.
Excellent.
All California workers.
And then they need a contract with the grower. The reason for this is, and growers don't give contracts, is because of wage theft. Wage theft is rampant among the farm worker population. They'll work for a grower for a period of time, and then the grower says, go away, and if you don't go away, I'll call ICE. And so they're either blacklisted or they're threatened with deportation. They live such difficult lives. And I was thinking, sitting here, we have an enlightened county. That's one reason I like living here. And I think it would really be great if we could serve as an example of a county that cares about the farm worker population and is reversing their slave-like conditions. We could be a beacon for the rest of the country. So if anybody has ideas on how we can move in that direction, I would really like to hear about it and would be happy to join with you in partnership. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anne, for sharing your experience. And Anne shared with me a copy of her book, if you're not familiar with it, The Farmworker Journey. And Anne can probably tell you where to find copies of that.
Amazon or UC Press.
I also want to thank Carol and the Democratic Women's Club, all of you for being here today. Program chair Mike Rotkin, longtime friend and ally on the picket lines. As you know, I currently serve as the majority leader in the California State Senate, but I cut my teeth in organizing, and perhaps the best teachers I've had in my life, having attended UC Berkeley and USF Law School, were Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta and leadership of the United Farm Workers Union. And if there's any takeaway from what you just heard from Ann and how we move forward, it's organization and organizing. So I started my work with the United Farm Workers Union in 1973. I was between undergraduate work at UC Berkeley and starting law school in the fall of 73. I worked in the grape strike in 73 in Delano, and then later up in Modesto at Gallo. 1973 was when the Teamsters moved in to take contracts that the UFW had won. People had said for years, farm workers can't be organized. They're immigrants, they don't speak English, they're undocumented. Growers exercise such tremendous disproportionate power that all organizing efforts had been crushed. As Mike mentioned, the history of immigrant labor in this state, in this nation, Chinese, Filipino, Japanese, Arab workers, Mexican immigrants, the Bracero program, which is a travesty, and now some people talk about immigration reform, bringing back the Bracero program. Anyone who says that should be confronted directly, because the Bracero program was shameful. Mostly single men came to California. They worked, and the condition of return was they would get paid when they went back to Mexico. But banks didn't pay them. There's been class action suits ordering Wells Fargo, Bank of America, banks that transferred money to banks in Mexico. Those workers did their part of the bargain. They never got paid. A shameful chapter in farm labor in California. But all of the advances, All of the breakthroughs came from organizing and organization. And as Mike pointed out, as Ann alluded to, under the Landrum-Griffin Act, not only were farm workers excluded, 1937, also domestic workers were excluded. What did they have in common? People of color. So farm workers were excluded from the right to organize. So in California, through the UFW, we achieved the Agricultural Labor Relations Act. That was some of my first work in Sacramento, was lobbying in 1974. We got it through once, Reagan vetoed it. It was our warm-up, it was our dress rehearsal. We elected Jerry Brown governor, January of 1975. He gets sworn in. We repass the ALRA and he signs it into law. But growers continued to have the leverage and the power of more money, more expensive lawyers, and the ability to tie up our victories at election boxes in the courts to the point where we would win the battle and lose the war. I worked in the longest ALRB hearing ever. It was 3.5 months, UFW v. Gallo. Teamsters had corrupted the election process, colluding with Gallo. They ran a counterinsurgency campaign against UFW. The leader of their security had run the Phoenix program in South Vietnam, the program to assassinate village leaders during the Vietnam War. They hired him to run the anti-UFW campaign. We won 41 unfair labor practice charges, and we had a new election ordered. We won every claim we had. The hearing went 3.5 months. We had over 100 witnesses, over 100 volumes of transcript, but then it was appealed, and it was caught up in appeal. We got that, the hearing was 77. We got our first decision in 78. The first appellate ruling came down in 82 that upheld our victory. But the workforce, it was migrant and transient. We lost the base that we had organized in 1975. So that's a little snapshot of the challenges, even when you have the law on your side. I do think, though, it's important not to leave here totally discouraged. Santa Cruz County is the first county in the state of California to extend health care coverage to all residents, regardless of immigration status. So the child of an immigrant worker has access to the Central California Health Alliance, access to clinics, access to health care. Now, we in the California legislature have extended Medi-Cal coverage to all children in California, regardless of immigration status. And we've also extended coverage through the ACA under threat now by the Trump administration. I want to talk a little bit about some recent legislative fights and victories. As pointed out, farm workers, because they weren't covered under the Landrum-Griffin Act and they weren't covered under other federal labor law protections, we've had to craft our own set of labor law protections for farm workers. The ALRA was a historic breakthrough, but the UFW has shrunk in strength since the 1970s because of the growers' ability to manipulate the law and the courts and even the appointments of members to the ALRB, the board that oversees the elections in the fields. Where the union has continued to have voice has been in the legislature and the legislative process, where we have an increasing number of Latino members. And I think one of the bright sides of the story of immigrant labor in California are the generations of farm worker children who've had access to our public school system, have been first generation college graduates, and now are doctors and lawyers working in our communities. And many of my friends and colleagues from UFW days, CRLA, California Rural Legal Assistance, first-generation college graduates now sitting on the bench as judges in Monterey, Santa Cruz County, around the state of California. Doctors running health clinics where they speak Spanish. They run bilingual clinics. But now with an increased immigrant workforce in our region of immigrants from Oaxaca, indigenous speakers, they speak some Spanish, usually related to commerce, negotiating wages or price, but when they come to a clinic, a bilingual doctor, my wife, needs an interpreter for
for Mistake, Mistek, Triki. It has no parallel. They're separate languages from each other, and they're not rooted in Spanish. And it's not a written language. So some doctors at UCLA have created a phonetic picture book for doctors and nurses and health workers to use for basic communication with non-Spanish or non-English speaking workers. But some of the gains that we've made, and again the challenge is enforcement, is enforcing labor laws that require rest breaks, lunch breaks, clean drinking water, access to bathrooms, and in the last few years, the fight to get shade in the wake of workers dying from heat stroke in the fields, a pregnant 19-year-old woman who died in the Central Valley because a crew boss wouldn't let her find shade or water when she was supposed to be working. It's really criminal, and the efforts to get criminal enforcement are often very difficult. When I first worked with the union in the summer of 73, we had 3,000 workers arrested on picket lines, exercising their First Amendment right, but violating court orders, and we had two workers killed, two of the UFW martyrs. The first case I worked on was the killing of Naji Daifula, a South Yemenese worker. The growers brought in Arab-speaking workers to try to prevent our effort to organize in Spanish by bringing in Arab speakers. UAW sent us Arab speakers from Detroit to help us organize. We had leaflets in Arabic. We organized the Arabic workers. They worked in solidarity with the Spanish-speaking workers. Naji Daifula was part of the strike in 1973. Two Kern County sheriffs beat his head in with flashlights, killing him. The coroner's report said it was justifiable homicide because those police had no way of knowing that an Arab had a thinner skull. That's not based on science. That's based on the racial bias of a coroner in Kern County. I took that case, the first time I met Caesar was to work on that case to interview witnesses to the killing, and we went to the FBI office in Bakersfield to file a federal civil rights claim for an investigation from the Justice Department. Nixon was president, a guy named Charles Colson was his legal advisor. He'd been counsel for the Western Conference of Teamsters, who we were at war with. We learned later after the impeachment, as we got Freedom of Information Act documents, that specific request filed in the FBI office in Bakersfield for a civil rights investigation, Colson instructed the then head of the FBI to not pursue that investigation. Nixon had the Department of Defense increase its buying of grapes and sent them to ships in Vietnam, where Latino sailors learned that they were scab grapes and threw them overboard. It was a Boston Tea Party in the Tonkin Gulf that made the New York Times. So the history of struggle is rich, and the lessons from it lead us to the conclusion that even the wins in the law books mean nothing if we can't enforce those laws. So in the wage area that's been discussed, for the first time in the history of California, been tried a lot, last legislative session, 2016, we passed the overtime pay for farm workers. Like every other worker in California, after 8 hours, you're entitled to overtime pay. The grower said, that's a bad move. We're not gonna hire workers for more than 8 hours. They're gonna make less than they would working 10 hours at minimum wage. So you're sentencing them to earning less because of making the law. What we found is there's a labor shortage right now. They are paying the workers overtime, and they will pay the workers overtime, because when they pay overtime, they're still making profits. And that's how the business works. So we brought farm workers into the same rules for overtime pay in California. We passed a minimum wage increase, the first state in California to come to $15 an hour for all workers. Farm workers aren't exempt, domestic workers aren't exempt. Some nonprofits under a certain number of employees have a more graduated implementation of that. other workers, we hit $15 an hour. I think it's by 2019 or 2020. So it's, we hit $11.50 an hour this next January. I think we're at $11 an hour now. So we will get to $15 an hour. When we get there, it'll have less buying power, of course, than it would today. On the health front, the pesticide issue, a lot of the work I did in litigation in the courts was pesticide poisoning cases in the Salinas Valley. As a result of that, some of our first lobbying efforts to get field postings, skull and crossbones for contaminated fields, that a worker will only abide by if they're a member of a union and they know they can refuse to go in. It's really more of an alert to the crew boss or the supervisor if they're at the wrong field. They see the skull and crossbones, they keep the crew out of the field. It has resulted in a reduction of mass crew poisonings. We continue to fight the methyl bromide used as a fumigant in the strawberries for years. It's highly toxic. It was also an ozone depleting chemical. The Montreal protocols that the US signed required the phase out of methyl bromide because of environmental impacts. So the growers said, we can't, methyl bromide, we're going to lose that tool, so we're going to bring in methyl iodide. Methyl iodide, not an ozone depleter, but more highly toxic for workers and rural residents. So when I was in the assembly, we led a campaign to get California to block licensing of methyl iodide. I led a letter, a colleague letter to Governor Brown. We met with the Department of Pesticide Regulation. And there was massive grassroots support against methyl iodide. The manufacturer withdrew its application for licensing in California. They continue to market it in other parts of the world, which is another lens we need to look through in terms of worker health and safety, environmental health and safety. We go this patchwork of chemical by chemical. Now we're fighting chlorpyrifos. But our victories in California that create some layer of protection, it doesn't stop them from marketing in other countries, exposing other workers, other children to that. In the arena of sexual harassment of farmworker women, it's epidemic, it's systemic. I think you can probably find it on YouTube now, Rape in the Fields profiles three farmworker women, one from the Salinas Valley. Dolores Huerta is one of the narrators in the documentary. That prompted me to introduce legislation about 3 years ago to require, as we have in other workplaces, mandatory sexual harassment prevention training for all farm workers. Of course, women being the victims more often than men, by 99% of the victims are women. But what we require is for the crew boss, the supervisors, and every worker has mandatory training in sexual harassment prevention in the appropriate language and with a phone number to call to report harassment or assault. And when you go from harassment to assault and rape, you go from civil violation to criminal violation. And in that film, Rape of the Fields, women who were rape victims and without exception, complaints to the police going uninvestigated, charges dismissed, charges never filed, and again, the collusion between the good old boys club, law enforcement, and growers. This won't end. That type of exploitation in the fields, our hope is we'll raise awareness and consciousness and give people an understanding that there are tools and pathways to protect themselves, to protect their daughters, and to find organizations like California Rural Legal Assistance that just won an $800,000 settlement on behalf of a woman who was the victim of sexual assault in strawberry fields. In Watsonville. And those legal victories do make a difference. Because again, what the growers understand is money. And when we've been able to raise the cost of doing business, then they get smart to protect their bottom line. So it's a good investment now to try to reduce sexual harassment if they're going to face $800,000 settlements. We brought my bill back. It passed 3 years ago. CRLA did a survey of farm workers coming into their offices for all different issues. Just said, did you get the sexual harassment prevention training? A high percentage said no. A high percentage said it was no more than 5 minutes. A lot of them said they weren't provided the written material that they were supposed to get in their preferred language. So I reintroduced this year Senate Bill 295. Dolores Huerta, we've worked closely together for years, now at 87. She's still organizing. And if you haven't seen the documentary, Dolores, that should be the other takeaway homework assignment from today's session. So we passed my bill this year. We put more teeth into it. We gave more fining authority to labor commissioners and more mandatory reporting for farm labor contractors, documenting their training sessions, documenting that they've handed out the materials, and they can lose their license after two violations of not doing it. So we can use the law. We can empower enforcement agencies to have more tools in their toolbox. So these efforts are not futile, but the implementation is not automatic based on enactment. So we have to enact the laws that put in the toolbox of enforcement agencies more means to go after the violators and create that culture where it's less expensive to obey the law than to violate the law. I just want to close. We'll open up to your questions. I'm working on a bill now. Ann alluded to the challenge of water quality for farmworker communities, for other disenfranchised communities. Everybody in this room has heard about Flint, Michigan, and lead. There are more Californians without access to clean, safe drinking water, tenfold more than those affected by lead in Detroit. And I don't make a practice of comparing disasters in scope, like our president seems to do. A disaster is a disaster. An injury anywhere is an injury to an individual or a family. But the well-kept secret in California is we have somewhere between 1.5 and 2 million Californians without access to clean, safe drinking water in about 300 communities. And one of those is Watsonville, where Chrome 6 requires building a treatment facility that will cost about $25 million. With a median income per family of $15,000 to $18,000 per family in Watsonville, they can't add enough to the water rates to pay for a $25 million facility. And that's one example. The other is ag nitrate contamination. It actually accounts for only about 30% of the contaminated water statewide. 70% is naturally occurring chrome 6, arsenic, lead, uranium. So there's not a culprit or a polluter that we can go after to pay for the remediation. So my bill, Senate Bill 623, has a broad coalition of environmental justice folks, environmental organizations, and agriculture who have come together. We negotiated for about the last 9 months and reached a historic agreement that creates a funding mechanism to raise $2 billion over the next 15 years to provide not just bottled water for these communities, but access to clean, safe drinking water. That could be through a treatment facility in Watsonville. It could be patching a small water district to a bigger one that can provide clean water. It could, in an emergency circumstance, pay for bottled water. But we've met people during the course of this effort who pay a monthly water bill, but they can't drink it, they can't cook with it, and they can't bathe with it. They can use it to water a lawn, maybe, or a vegetable garden. So they're paying $40, $50 a week for bottled water. And these are often people that also work in the fields or have worked in the fields. So it's a double whammy. They're being exposed to chemicals in the fields. Their water is not safe and clean. So our funding mechanism is if ag is responsible for 30%, they should pay 30% of the fix. But how do we raise the other 70%? My bill is controversial because I say every water ratepayer should pay up to 95 cents per month on their water bill to fund this solution. However, there's an exemption. If you're at 200% of the federal poverty line or below, you're exempt. You're not asked to pay 95 cents. But most of us who pay a monthly water bill, nobody likes rate increases, but we cap it at 95 cents. Based on the size of the water hookup, a business can pay $5 or $6 a month, mid-size, and a large industrial user, $10 to $15 a month. We've worked with the California Water Foundation, nonprofit, nonpartisan. They've done all the scientific research. The opposition we face are from big water districts, East Bay Mud, LA Water Empower. Why? They're fighting for the ratepayers. We don't want to pass this off to our ratepayers. Our response? California is the first of 50 states to establish the right to clean, safe drinking water as a human right in 2006. But we haven't fulfilled that declaration. My bill will bring safe, clean, affordable drinking water to all Californians. But we all have to hold hands to get there. And that's how I counter the water districts who say we don't want to pay a tax. You know, in Sacramento, a tax is a four-letter word. And we need two-thirds votes in each house. I have a Republican co-author, Senator Vidak from the Central Valley, a grower, who has a lot of constituents who don't have access to clean, safe drinking water. We moved it through the Senate. We held it in the Assembly because we were doing two-thirds votes on affordable housing, on transportation, on extension of cap and trade, and there was, quite frankly, fatigue trying to bend arms to get the two-thirds threshold. As opposed to losing, we decided let's wait and bring it, keep it alive, it's a two-year session. We'll re-engage the Assembly in January and work to get not just Democratic support, but Republican support to establish and fulfill this human right to clean, safe drinking water in California. I would like to get the Monterey County, the Santa Cruz County Board of Supervisors to support. They haven't yet. Monterey County Board of Supes has supported unanimously. They rarely agree on anything, but their growers want it as well. It doesn't let growers off the hook. They still have to do best practices. They have to reduce nitrate use. But they will be taxed through, if they're using nitrates, they're going to pay a higher tax on them, and dairy as well. So in that circumstance, the polluter pays, but they don't get off the hook of following best practices. They can still be prosecuted, no immunity from civil liability if we can prove health damage based on their practice. So I could go on. I'm going to close with two quotes. And then we'll hear your questions. One from Cesar Chavez, who said, once social change begins, it cannot be reversed. You cannot uneducate the person who has learned to read. You cannot humiliate the person who feels pride. You cannot oppress the people who are not afraid anymore. That was a speech he gave at the Commonwealth Club, 1984 in San Francisco. And then Dolores Huerta, again, still active, an organizer at age 87, worked with me on passing the End of Life Option Act that gives terminally ill patients a compassionate option for ending a terminal illness. Dolores's quote, that the history of the world, his story is told, hers isn't. Well, we're starting to tell her story. It's told in the documentary Dolores, produced by Carlos Santana. I highly encourage you to see that documentary film if you can. Thank you for your attention. And Mike, do you want to coordinate Q&A? Thank you.
So let me suggest you guys pull two chairs around so you don't stand the whole time. You know, light.
Are you okay standing?
Okay, I'll stand. So we'll take questions. I'd like them to be short. I don't care if they're controversial or tough, but they need to be short, and this is not a chance for a big speech about something. So, questions to either of our speakers, or just a question that will let them decide who would like to respond to it.
Can I make one comment? Yeah, I just wanted to say that one of the bonuses for the growers is NAFTA, because when you have a whole cadre of undocumented people, they're not going to organize. They live in constant fear. And that's, I think, the difference between this era and the Cesar Chavez era, that they're under the gun constantly.
I appreciate your mentioning that. Trump wants to undo NAFTA for different reasons. I didn't address immigration. We do need fundamental immigration reform, but it needs to happen at the federal level. I'm always disappointed that our agricultural leaders, who are mostly Republican, don't exercise a little more muscle in Washington. I know Congressman Panetta might have some thoughts on that as well. What we have done, we passed Senate Bill 54. People declare it makes California a sanctuary state. It's a little bit of a misnomer. We can't create protection or sanctuary for anybody who's technically not, is here, not under color of law. Federal agents can still detain them, they can still deport them. What SB 54 does, though, it says it's illegal to use local police resources, city, sheriff, state, to aid and abet federal ICE agents in their pursuit of undocumented workers. And people say, well, you shouldn't provoke the Trump administration. Now they're going to defund federal money for certain law enforcement agencies. We're suing them on that. We're represented by Eric Holder, who's representing the Democratic Senate caucus, the former attorney general, he and his law firm. We've filed a number of lawsuits, but on the immigration front, we didn't talk about DACA. We're not trying to provoke Trump. We're trying to send a message to the people we represent that we honor your contributions to our communities, to our economy, your taxes, your work in the fields, your work in the hospitality industry. We don't think that should be a deportable offense. And that bill, I was a proud co-author, led by President Pro Tem Kevin De Leon, who himself rode on a bus with his single mother from Tijuana to San Diego every day as a child while she cleaned homes of the wealthy. He was the first college-educated graduate in his family, now the president of the California State Senate, and a strong advocate, as you can imagine, for immigrant rights.
So I'm going to start with a question while you're thinking of yours, because I didn't see hands shooting up as they often do. It's a question to Bill. You know, in the newspaper, I wrote a comment, a letter to the editor about this recently, that Samuelson, the economist, you know, tells us everything you do in California to fix things, make things better for people, try and preserve possibilities for people when they retire, provide labor protections, et cetera, it costs too much, and it's going to bankrupt us, and we're all going under because of it. And Lisa's cartoons in the Sentinel, three times a week, whatever it is, driving me nuts. It's like, well, California's going under. They're doing all this stuff, but how are they going to pay for all this stuff? So that's my hostile question to you. Right. How are you going to pay for all this great stuff?
Well, I welcome the question. I would say it's more of a welcome setup than a hostile question.
Oh, it's a softball pitch.
So as you pointed out, Mike, in your opening, the strength of California's economy, we've never been stronger. We're the fifth or the sixth strongest economy in the world if we were a nation, over $2 trillion of gross domestic product. We're supporting that with a state budget of $127 billion, which is a lot of money. But as the engine for infrastructure, law enforcement, education, higher education, businesses are not leaving in droves. The number one state in the nation for venture capital investment is California. The number one investment of venture capitalists is renewable energy.
Yes.
That's consistent with our climate change objectives, but it's also good for our economy. We've created 500,000 jobs in the renewable energy field in one state, in California. 500,000 jobs in renewable energy. A lot of these are low-income technicians who get technical training and are working with installation of solar, wind energy, etc. They're good-paying jobs. Nationally, fossil fuel-related production jobs, total, nationally, 50,000. So we've created 10 times as many jobs in renewable energy. It's doing the right thing, not just for our state and the environment. We've become a model that other countries are looking at. So this myth that we're not business friendly and we're over-regulated, we've put more into public education this year than ever before. We still need to go farther, but per capita spending now over $11,000 per student. When I went into the legislature, we were 49th in the country for per capita spending. We've moved ourselves up to 33, 32. We're still not where we want to be, but we're moving in the right direction. So we're in still a rebuilding mode from the recession. We're probably going to hit bumps in the road ahead of time, but with that bright picture, it is important to also identify 25% of Californians are living in poverty, and that's true in my Senate district. I have the highest educated members living on coastal communities, bachelor's degrees or highest percentage of all 40 Senate districts, and I have 26% of my constituents living in poverty. That's immigrant workforce, ag, and hospitality tourism.
Your questions now. I'm not going to call my wife first.
Don't call me. Sure. Sure. She should get.
She'll get called. I'm not just
thank you.
I yield.
<knew. laughs>
Okay.
Yep. I would yield with everyone.
You have a question.
Yes.
Really loud.
Okay. Since you were talking about business, it used to be true, and I don't know if it still is. Doesn't every major company in the world always have a California headquarters? Sometimes it used to be LA and San Francisco. Now, what is that situation like? Does that tell us something about the money available?
So, a quick answer. I'm not sure of the answer to that. We do have companies that have moved their financial centers out of the U.S., out of California, not to pay domestic taxes. So that's another challenge we face. But California is the mecca for, certainly for technology, education, manufacturing. We still have manufacturing, but a lot of it has been outsourced as it has nationally.
But still have a company office.
Right. Well, Modern maintain an office in Sacramento to watch what we're doing.
Right. Yeah, okay. So they care.
Thank you for your presentation, Ann. And Bill, I don't know if you knew, but it's Santa Cruz County Affordable Housing Week. And it was kicked off on Thursday by the UCS No Place Like Home study, which shows that the demographics that, you know, the people who are paying the most for rent and are overcrowded are people who are of people like me, who are of people of color. Having said that, I know that there's been a lot of state bills that have been signed by the governor for more housing. However, is there anything in particular for farmworker housing? I know the George Springer Jr. Fund has been basically depleted, it's gone. And it was partially funded, I believe, by the Prop 1 C funds. So can you tell me, will George Springer Jr. come back?
Great question. The housing crisis affects all of California. Some people think, well, it's just the coastal communities. It's just Santa Cruz or Monterey. It's all over the state. It's more pronounced and more profound in the higher cost districts, but as costs get unattainable in the Bay Area, Santa Cruz, Monterey, San Luis Obispo County, there's more exodus inland, workforce driving longer distances to workplaces because they can't afford housing. We were at a meeting with of higher ed this week. UC Santa Cruz is planning to build 2,000 additional housing units for students, which will take some time, but it will relieve some of the pressure on rental units in the community. There's no single fix. Government has never been in the position to pay for housing. It's always been seen as the responsibility of the private sector. What we've done with a suite of 16 bills this year is try to provide incentives and ability of developers to develop housing with some specific focus on mentally ill homeless, We've repurposed $2 billion for mentally ill and homeless, knowing that building a place is critical to wrap around connection to Medi-Cal qualification, et cetera. That didn't used to be the norm. It used to be you got to be clean of drugs, alcohol before you qualify for housing. Now it's flipped. You got to get people a place, get them off the street to provide that support. The one thing that people here can do, one of our bills we passed by Senator Jim Bell, who led it, Senate Bill 3, I believe, it's a housing bond, affordable housing bond. That will go to the voters in 2018, and it will require a majority vote of California voters. It's believed that that $4 billion bond will attract $4 billion in federal money and another $4 billion in private developer money. So that $4 billion becomes $12 billion, and all communities will be eligible to apply for that. And I believe we can check, there's specific language in there about migrant housing. And also on the issue of the migrant camps, Ana Caballero, who represents Salinas Valley and Southern Santa Clara and Watsonville, she has a bill that's a two-year bill that would erase that 50-mile radius. And I've got the bill number in my file, so I'll mention that. I think the people to write that letter to would be the governor's office, and we'll revisit it in January. And I'll tell you what that bill number is right now.
So, Bill, does the water purity legislation that you're looking at, how is that tied to the governor's whole Delta thing?
It's not, is the simple answer. The Twin Tunnels looks at expanding conveyance north to south, getting more water to Westland growers, and interesting water to southern Santa Clara County. I have constituents in San Jose who depend on the water that gets pumped up into the San Luis Reservoir and then down into southern Santa Clara. So part of my district is dependent on Delta water. Most of my district is dependent on groundwater. Most of the contaminant issue we're dealing with is groundwater wells. So it's not really linked to that. And the Caballero bill is Assembly Bill 1165, and that's the one that would get rid. The history of that prohibition of living in a migrant camp year-round is, from the grower's point of view, they want to keep a source of migrant field labor. And their concern of taking public housing, making it full-time permanent, is that people won't stay working in the fields, they'll raise their kids, they'll go into other jobs, and then when it's harvest season, there's no place for migrant workers to stay. We think the merits of what Ann was addressing far outweigh that. And now we see growers going back to building farmworker housing because they can't afford the market housing. Tanimer and Antel and Salinas has just built a huge kind of state-of-the-art farmworker housing.
Yeah, I was just going to say I have postcards out on the out on the table to Housing and Community Development Director Ben Metcalf about modifying the 50-mile regulation. He could do it apparently with the wave of a magic wand. So if you can sign one of those and under your name put your zip code, I have stamps out there. I'm happy to mail them. Thank you.
Maybe a closing comment? Are we,
yeah.
How are we doing?
Yeah.
Because
there was a time when that 50-mile thing made sense because most of the farm labor was migratory, and they wanted to preserve that housing for the people who were most desperate to be able to get it. So it was not like done for an evil reason initially. But now almost all the farm labor in California is settled in various communities, and they're not moving, you know, along the migrant stream up to Oregon and back and so forth. So it doesn't make any sense anymore. It's time to change the law that, you know, no longer is relevant to what the real conditions are.
Yeah. A comment, it should be noted that the Democrat from the club wrote to the governor and to Director Metcalf,
yes.
Asking
Great.
Them to get rid of that into the living.
Yes.
Can
you.
I make this a closing comment? Because I see. Good. Again, I want to thank you all and the Democratic Women's Club for being here. Two pitches. I'm going to close with two pitches. One is this coming January marks a sad anniversary. 70 years ago, a plane full of migrants crashed in the Los Gatos Canyon, not our Los Gatos, but Los Gatos Canyon near Fresno. And I'm not gonna remember the exact number that perished. I think it was 32 workers, two flight crew, and one immigration officer. It made a headline in the New York Times that said, pilot, flight crew, immigration officer, they named them, and 32 deportees died. Woody Guthrie wrote a song called Deportee that Joan Baez made popular and famous, and many other artists have covered it. An author from Fresno named Tim, don't remember his last name, but his book is called All They Will Call You, because in the lyrics of the song, all they will call you will be deportee. He went and found family, surviving family members in Mexico, and how they learned of the fate of their loved one. They've now done a memorial, they were buried in a mass grave in Fresno that just said deportees. Now all of their names are posted there. January 28th is the 70th anniversary of that fateful plane wreck. The book he wrote, I highly recommend it. You can Google it, Amazon, All They Will Call You. Tim Hernandez. My second pitch and my close is I see Congressman Jimmy Panetta's here. I know he's gonna be speaking to you. Jimmy, in his first year in Congress, has been a champion for protecting DACA students and people in our district. We've been talking this morning about farmworkers, farmworker families, labor issues, but most of the DACA students, 800,000 nationally and the highest percentage in the state of California, came as children of immigrant workers, attended our public schools and higher institutions of higher learning, and for all intents and purposes, they're Americans. This has been their entire life. And Trump has been all over the map, executive order to take away their rights, then saying he hopes Congress will support their rights. We need to be a strong allied voice. But again, I just want to thank Jimmy Panetta for his leadership protecting the DACA workers.
Thank you all for coming out today and for your interest, and I'm hoping that working together we can see farm workers more as human beings that they are, with the same loves, hopes, dreams, and everything that the rest of us carry, and not just as implements of a farming system. I personally would like to see a transformation of the farming system to agroecological farming. There's been at least three studies, including a UN study, done that shows that if we converted to that overnight, we could feed the entire world's human population. We don't need the pesticides, and I think farmworker cooperatives would give everybody a chance for a better life. So thank you.
I want to thank you, and as we said, Jimmy Panetta, Congressman Jimmy Panetta is, when you're an adult and you call Jimmy, you don't want to use Congressman. You just resist, you just say Jimmy. Ann has made a copy available, and I didn't bring my door prize tickets this time. So I'm going to just arbitrarily say, if your birthday is closest to today's date, you'll be the recipient of this book. What's your birthday? Anybody in October? Anybody closer than October 26th? This is the 21st. Kathy gets this book. That's very appropriate because Kathy is a librarian and she went to grammar school, she went to kindergarten in this school. Her mother was our local librarian, so she became a librarian. So the other thing I want to say is, I would like to encourage you to take the farm worker tour, and there's information out on the table inside the postcards, because there's nothing like experiencing and hearing through and interprets on the tour from the farm workers who speak to you. And it's very moving, and I don't know about you, but when I first saw those Holocaust films, you just like, why didn't people say anything? Why didn't people do anything? And so I think the first action is to bear witness, and to bear witness is to like know that it's happening. It's happening in your community. There's a slave class of people living in this community. So, and the other thing I want to say is we have a board meeting. We have 5 board meeting members in this room. And we will bring up Bill's water thing and write a letter and see what we can do to lobby our supervisors to sign on to supporting the bill for clean water throughout the state.
Here, here.
So 2 meetings in 1. There you go. We're very privileged to have our Congress member, Jimmy Panetta, here with us today. We wrote Jimmy a letter. First of all, let me say the Democratic Women's Club endorsed Jimmy Panetta for Congress, and we're very pleased in general with the performance we've seen from him. He represents us on a wide range of issues, and we really think that he's doing a great job. It's very difficult to be in Washington these days, obviously, if you're a Democrat. I think it's difficult to be anybody in Washington. But we wrote Jimmy a letter concerned about the fact that he was a co-sponsor of a bill that, I'm going to not get too much into it because I want him to explain what he thinks he was supporting. But what concerned us was that it appeared to us that the bill that he was co-sponsoring made it a crime, basically, to support a boycott against Israel. And it particularly came in relation to a UN resolution that caused some people to organize a boycott. And this had to do not boycotting Israel for its existence, obviously, but because of what's going on with settlements in the West Bank and the policy over settlements. And so we thought, you know, whether you agree with the boycott or disagree with it, First Amendment should allow people to stand up and represent their views and not be punished with quite severe penalties, actually, if they're found guilty of violation for organizing a boycott, for being involved in this kind of a boycott activity. So he wrote them a letter. He asked if he would, you know, he wanted to speak to us about why he did it, what his views are, and so forth. We're fortunate in Santa Cruz. We sometimes have craziness here, but we are not going to have the craziness in this room that goes on in this country when people see their Congress members. This will be a civil conversation. We can ask hard questions. We can definitely be pointed about the concerns that we have. And certainly the Middle East is an area for lots of severe disagreements where people feel very passionate about the issues. Nonetheless, this will be a civil conversation. And I want to start by asking him to talk about this. He may have other things he wants to speak with us about as well, but we'd like him to explain what his view is about this issue. Jimmy.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. First of all, do I need a microphone?
No.
Okay. Is that all right? I'm practicing court of law as a prosecutor, so I'm used to using my courtroom voice. And the second thing I'm asking, if it's okay if I take off my jacket.
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate that, Mike, and obviously appreciate the Democratic Women's Club of Santa Cruz County and the support that they provided me, not only in the campaign, but during my limited time in Congress. And in regards to the HR 1697, I'll get to that, and I think that is a separate topic, but I also wanted to take this opportunity to talk to all of you. And just to kind of fill you in as to what the hell I've been going through for the past 9 months, if that's okay, if I can be able to take that chance. You know, it's funny because, and I get this all the time, a lot of people, when they see me, they say, oh, you know, you're in Congress. And then before they can say anything else, I'm so sorry for you at this point. And I heard that last night even at the Monterey County Democratic Central Committee annual fundraiser that they had, a wonderful event, had a hell of a turnout, and as most Democratic events, it goes too long, but that's all right, because they raise a lot of money, they do good for the Central Committee. I admit, as a freshman member, it's been an absolute whirlwind. It has been crazy, it's been nutty, and we've been consistently dealing with it. You start off with, new member orientation. I go in there literally the week after the campaign. Boom, 23 Democrats, about 25 Republicans are there figuring out how to be Congress members, what to do. Now, I was lucky enough that I kind of had a little bit of leg up based on my being back there, and that I actually knew that there was a tunnel from the Cannon Office building to the Capitol and things, you know, directions and where to go, which helped out quite a bit, because you can just imagine there are members who haven't spent much time in Washington and really didn't know where to go or what to do. So that put me ahead of the game. And then come January 3rd, when we raised our hand and got sworn in, that was fine, and that was a good experience, great experience, obviously. But then, literally, that day, we're voting. We are voting. And let me tell you, it's been voting ever since. And, you know, I'll put it out there. I've done this week in a few talks I've given. No one's got this right yet. How many times do you think you've actually pressed the button in the 9 months I've been there? Press the little button to vote. Give me an idea.
Two.
Ah, that's funny. Thank you, Carol. 568 times. 568 times. Now, mind you, all of those aren't pieces of legislation. But the majority, after 8 years with the Democratic president, they took advantage of that Congressional Review Act, which basically takes away a lot of the regulations and protections that Obama put in place within the last year of his administration. And so they were cranking away. And they have been ever since. Obviously, I pressed no quite a bit, but I can tell you, and I'll get to the fact that we have pressed yes on some issues as well. And then came January 20th with the disorientation of having President Trump in the White House. And it's basically gone, as you know well, but I have to repeat some of these things. You know, from the cabinet picks to his closest advisors' resignations, to the executive orders, including ones that threatened the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary, to an equivocation on what happened in Charlottesville, to the threats to annihilate a company, to the constant tweets, to maligning his own Republican leadership, and then the next day having a press conference with the same leaders. Then the next night having Chinese food with Chuck and Nancy, as he called them. And then obviously standing up to the investigation, Russia's involvement in our campaigns, to a controversy of taking a knee during the national anthem. I mean, it's one thing after the other, constantly. Yet, we still have so many things to do. By December 8th, let me just tell you, by December 8th, let's run through a couple of things that we in Congress has to tackle, okay? By December 8th, we have to come up with a way to fund the government. We have to raise the debt ceiling. We have to deal, of course, with our dreamers. We have to deal with the Iran decertification of the JCPOA. We have to reauthorize our children's health insurance program. And they think they're going to come up with a tax reform package. And wouldn't it be nice to have some sort of infrastructure package there too? I mean, it's been, as I've said it, and I continue to say this, unfortunately, it's been governing by flurry and not governing by focus. And let me tell you, the Congress, from what I've experienced, we need focus, okay? Because look at what has just come at us just this past week alone. Not this week, but the week, last week. You just go through a couple of things that happened last week. He withdrew from the Clean Power Plan, or showed the administration's intent to withdraw from it. He repealed employer birth control mandates. He put forward a very strict set of immigration principles. He stopped the cost-sharing reduction services and put forward an executive order that created alternative insurance plans. He decertified the Iran deal. He posed with his military advisors and gave the quote of, "This is the calm before the storm." All at the same time that we're still burying the victims of one of the most horrendous shooting, mass shootings in our country's history in Las Vegas. We're trying to deal with recovery efforts in Puerto Rico, still in Houston even. And California's experienced its deadliest and most destructive wildfire. This is all in 1 week, and that's what we're dealing with. And you look at what has been going on in the last 8 months, and what you have to just come to realize, and what you all know, is that there's just been this undermining of 8 years of protections that have been put in place. We talked about the executive orders, his tweets about getting rid of the tweet to install a military transgender ban. Unbelievable. Without his military advisors even knowing what he was doing, this is what he does. Last week, we voted on the 20-week abortion ban, the third time in 5 years that we voted on that. Democrats voted no. Republicans voted yes. The Senate will take it up. Unfortunately, vote no and voted down again. He rolled back Title IX guidance on sexual assaults. We withdrew from the Paris Climate Accords. And as I mentioned, they announced his intent to repeal the Clean Power Plan. But when he did this, the EPA director, Scott Pruitt, said, we're doing this because the CPP is a war on coal. I, as I've said, and I'll say it today, I believe that things that the administration is doing is not just a war on our environment. It's a war on our children. It's a war on our party. It's a war on our country. It is the war on the future of the United States of America, I feel like. I read an editorial, I think it was last week, and the title of the editorial was, We Used to Build Things. And the author talked about the big burn that happened early on in the 1900s, a huge fire that went from, I think, Oregon and Washington into Idaho, even into Montana. A lot of devastation. And from that burn, though, what happened was something was created out of the ashes. And that was our Department of Forestry. And when I read that, I thought about everything that we did create during the 20th century. That we have a history of creating civic institutions whose goal is to help people. And then you take it one step further, and you think about that with that construction, with the building of these types of institutions, we've advanced the ideas. Okay, this is what we're about, advancing the ideas of freedom, of equality, in our democracy. We embrace people, especially those yearning, those huddled masses yearning to breathe free. And when we embrace them, we embolden them, and we give them that opportunity to realize their powers. And in return, you know what happened? The world embraced us. And the world flocked to our, as I say, our enlightened leadership. That's what we had, you know? And that's, to me, that is what made us exceptional. Yet we've had so much distraction, we've had so much devastation, we've had so much divisiveness, we've had so much deconstruction, that of course we could appreciate the kind of nostalgia for what we have. But the fact is, you can't help but asking the question, because America always defines itself by the future, not a reliance on its past, but on the future and what the future holds, you have to start asking yourselves, and I'm asking myself as a congressman, when are we going to start building things again? When are we going to start building things again? And I can tell you, though, as you know, that it can't happen. And of course it can happen right here on the Central Coast. And I believe it can happen in Washington, D.C. too. Because of what we build here on the Central Coast. Because of the motivation that you give me on the Central Coast. Last Friday, not yesterday, but a week from yesterday, I attended the reopening of the Pfeiffer Canyon Bridge down in Big Sur. Yeah. And, you know, standing on that bridge, seeing the Big Sur community down there, seeing other community members from the Central Coast who came to that reopening, it to me, that told the story, yes, of what Big Sur stands for, how resilient the individuals in that community is. But it also demonstrated to me that when government comes together, when people come together, we can build things. We can do things in a record amount of time. That bridge was built, by the way. But at the same time, it made me realize this is governing by crisis. We had to get that bridge built. And I believe that it's time that we start governing by leadership and taking those steps. And I can tell you that in Washington, D.C., although you're hearing about all the things I've said, and you turn on the TV and, you know, you turn it right off, I'm sure. But the fact is that there is slow construction being done, especially at that institution. Now, obviously, as a Congress member, and what I'm seeing from other members, our number one priority is making sure that our constituents are served, okay? I realize that in the household that I grew up in, with a not just a father, but a mother who was his district director, who worked their tails off to serve the constituents. That's what the job is about. That's the number one priority. Because even to this day, people still come up to me and they tell me about the service they received from their Congress member. I'm not just talking, a year ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. These are stories about service to these individuals 30, 40 years ago, yet they make it a point to tell me about that. And to me, that's what this job's about. You can actually do your job, be that bridge from the Central Coast, from the people on Central Coast, to the government in Washington, D.C., the services of our government in Washington, D.C., and back. And when you do that, you can affect people's lives, you can affect their family, you can affect their future. That's why I'm standing in front of you in this position, to be honest with you. That's what drew me to this job. No better job to serve people, I believe, based on what I've seen. But there's also my representation of not just the people here in a number of ways. Obviously with casework and those services, but in any way possible, then people contact our office. And let me tell you, people have been contacting our office. Let me give you the stat that I have, another one. Last year, Sam Farr's office, Congressman Sam Farr, in 1 year, there were 42,000 forms of communication into his office. Emails, phone calls, letters, walk-ins, 42,000 total.
Is that the local office?
That is Washington, Santa Cruz, Salinas.
All three.
All three. Mm-hmm. This year, in 9 months now, three offices, we have had 82,000. Now, most of those come from the zip code here in Santa Cruz. Okay? And that's fine. That's good, let me tell you. That is just fine. Exactly. But it's my job to also to be there for those phone calls, those emails. That's what this position is about, okay? And let me tell you, the best thing you can tell me is that I contacted your office and I got a response. And the worst thing you can tell me is I contacted your office and I didn't get a response. Either way, I want to hear. Okay? I want to hear. Because I believe it is our job to respond to you no matter what you have to say, no matter what the issue is, no matter what the casework is. That's our job. Now, I also feel that there's leadership shown in Washington based on the committees that I'm on. I was for 6 months on the Natural Resources Committee, a very partisan committee, I'll tell you that right now. Most of the votes that we took were pretty much across party lines. Republicans would vote one way, Democrats would vote the other. But I have to tell you, based on my time on that committee, it's where you started to, you learned about things that were important, especially to us on the Central Coast. It's why, based on my being on the Natural Resources Committee, the first two bills I co-sponsored had to do with protecting the California coast and the West Coast from offshore oil drilling, co-sponsored with Jared Huffman. But it was also, exactly, it was also that a committee in which I was able to get my first bill through committee onto the House floor, out of the House and into the Senate, and that's opening up a Clear Creek management area in South San Bernardino County. Reopening this Clear Creek management area, 60,000 acres for off-road activity, but also preserving another 20,000 on top of that, right next to it, for wilderness purposes. Like I said, it was a bipartisan bill. I had to go into the chairman, Rob Bishop in Utah, very conservative guy. I had to go into his office, basically kind of kiss the ring, this guy. Talk it through with him, why it benefits not only the environment, why it benefits the people, why it benefits the Central Coast. Unfortunately, he understood, he talked it through, and I also had co-sponsors. And Republican co-sponsors, Jeff Denham, David Valadao, Steve Knight, they are in the valley. It's right along the valley there. They understood that as well. But it's going to benefit the people of the Central Coast. And I believe that that's why it's passed unanimously out of the Natural Resources, unanimously out of the House. Now we're working with Feinstein and Harris to make sure it gets passed in the Senate and on it on Trump's desk. I'm on the Armed Services Committee. Okay? And I believe that being from Monterey County, being from the Central Coast, We have a number of military installations that play a role in our national security. I'm not talking about planes, tanks, and guns, because we know that our military forces aren't just about that anymore. But they are about leadership, cybersecurity, the weather, languages. They're about those things that we have there on the Monterey Peninsula. Navy Postgraduate School, Defense Language Institute, Fleet Numerical Weather Lab, Navy Research Lab. All these installations that are very important to our national security, but of course they're very important to our community down there in Monterey, and I have to do my best to fund them, to protect them, and ensure that those installations continue to be a part of our national security. But being on the armed services, it's also why I have co-sponsored and offered a new authorization use of military force. Okay, AUMF, as you've heard. You know how long the current AUMF has been around? 01, 02. It's outdated. And now we have a bipartisan AUMF that basically is more targeted and has a sunset clause of 5 years to limit that authorization of use of military force. And that, I think that's very important. It's also why that I have co-sponsored Restricting the First Use of Nuclear Weapons Act. Because I believe that this president needs to go to Congress before he uses or thinks about using any sort of nuclear weapon. And so I'm part, I co-sponsored that. And the other committee I'm on is the Agriculture Committee. Obviously the number one industry in this area, as we've heard about, you heard about earlier today, as you know about having being from this area, it's very important in our work on the upcoming 2018 Farm Bill that basically our specialty crops are protected. We have the proper research and development when it comes to our organics, our specialty crops. And it's also important making sure that the most important thing in that field is protected as well, and that's our farm worker. You know that too. And so I, as a voice of the Central Coast, it's my job to make sure that those things are protected and taken into account in the 2018 Farm Bill. And we're also representing the Central Coast and showing leadership when it comes to our values, when it comes to our values here on the Central Coast. The caucuses that I'm on, the first two caucuses that I signed up on, LGBT caucus and the pro-choice caucus, okay? Because I'm on the LGBT caucus, myself and Adam Schiff have recently co-sponsored, Adam Schiff, the congressman from down south, have co-sponsored legislation that gave the Census Bureau funding to study the need for sexual orientation and gender identity questions in the national census. Because look, we believe that proper policy deserves proper evidence upon which it is based. And so this is something that we put forward in legislation, and we're working on getting other co-sponsors. Now, and obviously being on the pro-choice caucus, that's very important, especially now, especially considering the backdrop of the Trump administration, where we are fighting every day to preserve and protect a woman's reproductive rights. And we're doing this through a number of ways. Obviously, I spoke of the vote, the 20-week abortion ban vote that we took 2 weeks ago, but also getting on record with a number of letters to the Speaker and the President talking about efforts, their efforts, and how concerned we are with their efforts to undermine Title 10 family planning, to basically putting forward, they are putting forward, we believe, policies that harm women, their policies to reinstate the global gag rule, rolling back of the employer mandate on birth control. That's also why I've co-sponsored H.R. 671 that reverses the global gag rule, why I've co-sponsored the Women's Health Act and the Each Woman Act. And it's also why I'm co-sponsoring support the Paycheck Fairness Act, supporting the minimum wage, raising the minimum wage, as well as paid family leave for men and women. Okay. And another area that I can say that when I have pressed the button and pressed it for yes, is an area that is important here on the Central Coast, and that's our veterans. And that's a very, we've done a lot of work in Congress when it comes to our veterans. We passed the Clear Choice Act. Basically what that says is that if a VA, if a veteran can't get a medical assistance from the VA, they then have ways to go to their private doctor, temporary way to do that. We're lucky here on the Central Coast, especially with the opening of the General Borley DA, DOD VA Health Clinic down there in the former Fort Ord. But we also have Palo Alto. And, you know, it may have its faults, but let me tell you, it's nothing compared to other VA hospitals throughout the nation. We're actually very lucky here. But you have to realize that there are other VA hospitals across the nation where our veterans aren't getting medical service they need. And so that's why I believe that Freedom of Choice Act was important. We passed the GI Forever Bill, basically saying that if you're a GI, if you're a veteran, no longer do you have GI benefits just within 15 years, but you have for all of your life to take advantage of your GI benefits. Myself and a freshman class member, a friend of mine, Republican Neil Dunn, we co-authored and got passed out of the House a bill that says that if you're a small-owned business, and it's a veteran small-owned business, you get preference in dealing with the federal government. That's another thing we did. That's a time, I'm telling you, when it comes to veterans, it is a time where you're seeing a lot of bipartisan support. I'm on the Climate Solutions Caucus, okay, a purely bipartisan caucus. And what that means is that the same amount of Democrats and the same amount of Republicans on this caucus, sitting around the table, actually talking about the effects of climate change. And I can also tell you that it wasn't easy for me to get on that, because it wasn't easy for me to find a Republican willing to get on that. It actually took me two tries. The first try, I had a freshman member from Jacksonville, and I saw him on the House floor, and I said, hey, would you like to join the Climate Solutions Caucus? And he said, yeah, that sounds good. Have your staff call my staff. Okay. So I go back to the office, call up this Congress member, talk to him about getting on the Climate Solutions Caucus. Staff calls one time, no answer. They call again, no answer. Third time we call him, he says, the staff says this. Yeah, the congressman's not ready to join the Climate Solutions Caucus. Okay, fine. So I said, well, who else can there be? And I remember reading National Geographic, I think it was last year, about Norfolk, Virginia having dry day flooding in Norfolk, Virginia, the effects of rising sea levels. And I thought, well, that's, you know, it's not only a community security issue, it's a national security issue, because in Norfolk is a major Navy base. Scott Taylor, former Navy SEAL, Republican, represents that area. Go to him on the House floor. I hear you about the, you know, your dry day flooding in Norfolk. You want to join the Climate Solutions Caucus, start talking about this? He says, yeah, that sounds good. Have your staff call my staff. So I did it one time. Staff called, didn't get a response. I then tell my staff, stop, don't worry about it, let me take care of it. We have votes, I think it was that night or the next day. I see him on the House floor, I go down, across the aisle, I sit down with him to have a conversation. Scott and I are now on the Climate Solutions Caucus. But that's what it takes, And it worked out, and because of my being on the Climate Solutions Caucus, I then introduced legislation 3 weeks ago dealing with Carlos Covella, Republican from Miami, the co-chair of the Climate Solutions Caucus, basically making sure that the flood resiliency standards are in place. That's the flood, that was the standard that Donald Trump wiped out a month ago, said no longer do people who are building federally funded projects, do they have to abide by the flood resiliency standard? Our bill would say, yes, you do. And so it was nice having bipartisan support on that and putting that forward, and we will continue to work on that. It's also why I'm on another caucus that is dealing with the Affordable Care Act. Okay. Now, as you know well, I am for universal health care, and I do support the legislation that's coming out of the Senate that a number of senators are putting forward with Medicare for All, Medicaid for All, Stabenow, Murphy, Kane, Bennett, recently put forward kind of foundational steps towards universal health care. But I also know that at this point, as we've seen and as we agree, I believe, the ACA needs to be saved, okay? Based on the unfortunate chipping away at it, as we saw 2 weeks ago by President Donald Trump. We all realize here on the Central Coast how beneficial the ACA was to this area. okay? The uninsured rate went down from 21% to 9%, created 6,500 jobs. 20 million people were insured across the U.S., 5 million in California. A lot of good things from the ACA. But you also realize, though, that undercovered California, the central coast of California, had the highest rate hike in California, 27% in 2017. Number two was San Francisco County at 14%. So it did need to be repaired. Not repealed, though, because of the good that it's done, but we needed to repair it. And now, with the cutting off of the cost subsidy reduction, the cost sharing reduction subsidies, it does need to be repaired. And so this caucus that I'm on had a working group that put forward some principles to shore up the individual market. We saw that, bipartisan principles. And Senator Burry from Washington, Democrat, Senator Lamar Alexander from Tennessee, Republican, in their hearings that they held in the Senate, they relied on those principles to come up with their compromise after their hearings that they put forward just this week to save the individual market. But you have to realize that the ACA is very partisan, okay? I didn't realize that. I had a sense. Obviously, we had a sense, okay? But let me tell you, in talking to members who were there back in 2010, when they tell you how they felt the ACA was put forward and pushed through by the Democrats, there's a bitterness that comes out. And it was unfortunate. I heard a story from Joe Barton, a longtime Republican Texan, who, when he told me the story, like I said, it just oozed out of him. But then it's unfortunate, though, and then I believe it pervades the discussion so much that you have a quote from Tom Cole, Republican from Oklahoma, after the Murray-Alexander bipartisan deal was agreed on this week, you have Tom Cole saying, none of our guys voted for Obamacare. They're not interested in sustaining it. That is the attitude. But that attitude is not going to stop us from trying to save the ACA. And I can tell you there are Democrats and Republicans who understand that, and we're actually working together to shore up that market. We'll continue to do that. And I can tell you that there are Democrats and Republicans working on a deal to save something that's very important, something that Bill mentioned, something that we all know is very important, our Dreamers, especially here on the Central Coast. One in four Dreamers live in California, okay? 220,000 in California. Number two is Texas, 120,000. Number three, Illinois, 40,000, okay? There are states without any Dreamers. Okay, if Hartnell College was a state with its nearly 900 Dreamers, it would be ranked number 39. We understand that on the Central Coast. As a grandson of county immigrants, I get it. You get it. We understand how important our Dreamers are. And if you talk to these Dreamers, as I have, met with them a number of times, and you hear their stories about the hurdles that have constantly been put up in front of them. I mean, time after time after time, and the efforts that they take to get over them again and again and again, you realize that these Dreamers are American in every way, but for on paper. And I can tell you that we're working hard to change that, okay? We're dealing with the Dream Act. We're dealing with the RAC Act. We're trying to come up with ways in which we can agree upon to make sure that these Dreamers get their citizenship, a pathway to citizenship. But at the same time, just like Leader Pelosi and Leader Schumer have said, it's a compromise. In the extent that, yes, we can talk about border security, it sure as hell isn't going to be a wall. Okay, that's not on the table. Let me tell you that right now, all right? But we all understand that we can deal with border security and technological advances to make it more secure. Not a wall, but the necessary advances and improvements to make it more secure. Okay, we understand that. And we're trying to come up with a deal to do that. In fact, we've had late night sessions on this caucus that I'm on to deal with that. And it was so funny because there was a Democratic member who was on this working group. We were up in the fifth floor of the Cannon Building in a cramped office till about 11:30 at night. And we left that office building, and we were both kind of, you know, like, that was neat for me. It was great to be a part of it. And this guy had been there 12 years, and he turned to me and he said, Jimmy, I've never done something like that before. I mean, that's kind of what's been happening. But I'm telling you, there are members there, Democrats, and yes, Republicans, who are ready to get things done. And I sensed that from the very beginning when I went to new member orientation. I don't sense that, I heard that. But not at first, because what happens at first when you get to new member orientation as a freshman member is that you get there and literally you get in the room and leadership, unfortunately, puts the Democrats on one side and the Republicans on the other. And for 2 weeks when we were in Washington, D.C., we weren't with each other. We weren't talking to each other, and we didn't get to know one another. It wasn't until our third week up in Harvard, when we went to a symposium up there at the JFK School of Government, that we were actually sitting at the same table. We were actually starting to talk to one another. And it got to a point where we said, leadership, we want you to leave the room. And it was where Democrats and Republicans were talking, and we basically, I heard what I heard from many of you during the campaign. And I heard from many of my constituents here on the Central Coast. And that it is time for us to start getting things done in Congress. And that it is time that when we do that, we do it together. We firmly believe that. And so, you know, I leave you with this for my opening comments to say that there are people who want to build things in Washington, D.C. and not just tear it down. And yes, it is not just the Democrats. There are Republican members who want to do that. And to me, that gives me some hope. Okay? That gives me hope. But at the same time, we also know that this president has to realize that he is governing a democracy, not an autocracy. And that he has to realize that he is not alone. And that we need to come together as a party to make sure that he understands he's not alone in 2018 and in 2020. And to let him know that, okay, with the way we vote. And to make sure that, yes, we continue to resist, you bet, okay? But we continue to be reinvigorated and we continue to reconstruct what we know we can have together. We've done that. We did that on day one. What I mean by that is January 21st, okay? January 21st, the Women's March. I will never forget being in Washington, D.C. on that mall and not being able to move because there were so many people. And it was not a march. It was more of a shuffle. But I'll never forget, obviously, the feeling that I felt from everybody around me, including many constituents from Santa Cruz who were there. But I'll never forget looking back. So we were on the mall. We couldn't get over to where the stage was, which was a street over right in front of the Native American Museum. We were on the mall, and I'll never forget looking back up, looking east, up at the Capitol, and literally seeing on both sides of the Capitol a sea of pink just flowing down, and it just kept on coming. For the hours that we were on the mall, it's unbelievable. But that's something that we can't forget. And that's something I believe that as Democrats, we have to hearken back to that and we have to use that to know that we can come together. And we can make sure that we can build things. We can build that bridge within our party, I believe within our nation, and I believe so that we can be that bridge from the Central Coast to our government in Washington, D.C., that I always say, we firmly believe that is a government which is of, by, and for we the people. So let's talk about Israel. H.R. 1697 is a bill that is, I believe, based on my reading of it, you have to realize that there are a number of members in Washington, D.C., I hate to say this, but it's true, that do not read the bills. Okay? They rely on staff. I have read this bill, and I want to make it clear that I would never support any bill that violates our First Amendment to free speech. I would never support any bill that violates the First Amendment to free speech. And based on my reading of this bill, and based on my reading of the surrounding case law, I believe that this bill does not violate our free speech. I say that because this bill deals with the Export Administration Act only, 1977 and 1979. And honestly, I would ask, and I hope I get an honest answer, who has heard of the Export Administration Act of 1977, 1979, before this came out? You probably did. Exactly. And what this bill does, okay, the Export Administration Act, what that says is that prohibits U.S. citizens from complying with unauthorized boycotts by a foreign country. That's what the Export Administration Act says, okay? And that came about because you had a number of Arab countries back in the 70s that were doing what? They were boycotting Israel because Israel was Israel and they didn't like Israel, okay? So they were boycotting. And so Congress put forward this law, created that law that says, once again, prohibits U.S. citizens from complying with unauthorized boycotts by a foreign country. Now, what does H.R. 1697
mean? Authorized by whom?
Unauthorized.
Unauthorized by whom?
I would imagine it would be the U.S. government.
Oh.
Okay.
So, with the U.S. government.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. What H.R. 1697 does is it prohibits U.S. citizens from complying with unauthorized boycotts by international government organizations. It adds that international government organizations. And Mike, please speak up if I'm off on anything, or if you disagree. But that's what this bill does, okay? Now, that in itself, I believe, does not violate our right to free speech. Because all that says is exactly what I said. And so if you as an individual want to BDS Israel, you can. If you as a company want to do BDS towards Israel, you can. And if you as an individual or as an individual company want to speak out and criticize Israel, you bet you can. Okay? Because yes, we know that there are the policies within the Israel government that deserve to be criticized. Of course. But this bill does not violate your right to do that.
Okay, so Jay, let me lay out.
Yeah.
Slightly with respect to the chance to respond to it.
Yeah.
So this international organization is the United Nations. The United Nations General Assembly passes a resolution that condemns the expansion of the settlements on the West Bank, Palestine, however you want to define it, but the West Bank, also in Israel. And what it says is not only is that an individual citizen faces penalties, crime, civil and criminal penalties, if they support that boycott. So if I want to say, hey, I think the United Nations did the right thing in this boycott, I support their call for a boycott because I think, you know, I support the right of Israel to exist, but I think the settlements are destructive, not only to Palestinians, but to Israel's own security. That we can get that, I'm not going to get to that level of stuff.
Right, right.
But based on my views about that, I would say, I think the UN did the right thing, and I want to support their resolution, and therefore I urge you, Jimmy, and I urge you, Madeline, and I urge you, for each person in the room, I urge you, don't support anything that like ends up supporting Israel over the stuff in the West Bank. And so I want you to support that boycott. And so this act says, by supporting the UN, this international organization's boycott, my free speech is restricted because I can face penalties for encouraging others to support that boycott. And I do support that boycott, and I think it's a correct one, and I don't want to face penalties from the federal government for doing so. So that's how I read it.
And I disagree with that interpretation.
Okay.
I disagree with that interpretation. It's basically if you are complying with the international government organization. Okay? And what I mean if you're actually working with them on that. Now that means that you can do it on your own. You and other businesses can do that. You and other people here in Santa Cruz or in the Central Coast across this nation can do your own BDS. You can do that. But what stemmed from the Export Administration Act is when there were surveys put out by foreign governments to people, and you comply with that survey about dealing with BDS, things like that. Complying with that other country or that international government organization, that is a violation. But it's not a violation if you want to speak out against it, but other people to speak out against it and get other people to basically work with doing BDS.
I will give you the last word, and I won't speak again, but just
go ahead.
No, it helps to make a chart. But if I understand, if I take a copy of the UN resolution, it sounds like I'm talking about this international organization, and I send you a copy of this resolution, from the UN, and say, I hope you'll support this boycott that they're calling for. Isn't that a classic example of me supporting the UN's boycott and therefore in violation of this act? And I'll stop there.
No, I don't think it is. At least based on my reading of what drew the EAA was basically more of a direct compliance, direct working with a government in order to do that boycott. Okay, I believe that's not. And don't get me wrong. I think this bill could be clarified more. Okay, I really believe that. For instances like that, to reassure people that are concerned with that free speech aspect of it, to say that no, you can't speak up in support. It's that actual complying with that international government organization or that country directly to do that. Okay, so there could be clarification, and there should be clarification, Mike. And if this bill actually gets to the floor, with its 266 co-sponsors, Democrat and Republican, who have co-sponsored this bill, bipartisan bill, that there will be amendments. But I think even before it does, that the senators, Cardin, especially Ben Cardin from Maryland, Democrat, I'm sure that they will write this to make it more clear and precise to alleviate those types of workers.
So the ACLU had initially opposed the bill that we talked about, which was in response to the Arab countries organizing a boycott. They backed off once it was made clear that this had to do with the permission of people who were not coming from Saudi Arabia or whatever. They are still opposing this bill. So my only suggestion, again, rather than arguing out to the end, we're not going to get there, would be to look closely at what the National American Civil Liberties Union says about this bill and its relation to the First Amendment, because I've had different uses of the ACLU over a variety of things. I've been a member since I was 12. I think they're a good source for trying to figure out, rather than just depending on your own, even though you're an attorney, rather than simply depending on your own reading of this, you might want to ask the ACLU, how do they read this and its impacts on the First Amendment?
And I would recommend reading the case law of the federal courts that talked about, basically dealt with this issue with the Export Administration Act. Train v. Baldrige at 552-1378, Briggs and Stratton v. Baldrige at 728-9-2-915. And what they basically said is these types of speech, okay, it's commercial speech. Therefore, commercial speech can be limited, as we know, okay? Free speech cannot, all right? And the example that I've seen is, to kind of explain that further, is let's say next door to you was a member of the KKK, and he put up a sign that said, I hate African Americans and Jewish people. The ACLU and courts have said that that's free speech, okay? But if they then put up a sign and said, house for sale, not for sale to African Americans and Jewish people, that can be regulated. That's commercial speech that can be regulated because it's discriminatory. That's the same analogy that the federal courts used in upholding the Export Administration Act when it came to that law that I mentioned earlier. And so that's, I believe, it doesn't violate. Now, what I've heard is, and what people have said to me, is that it chills free speech. It raises red flags. It's antithetical to free speech, okay? That doesn't mean it violates free speech. But I do believe that the law could be clarified so it doesn't chill free speech. And that's what I think should happen with this bill.
Thanks for coming and responding. Our dialogue will continue. Of course. But just say, you know, I want to make sure there's a chance. We have about 10 minutes left.
Sure.
Just ask others if they have questions.
Yeah.
Not really the test issue necessarily.
I want to ask for clarification. When you were talking about the pro-choice coalition,
yeah,
and you made reference to the global gag rule,
right,
but I didn't understand. I know what that is, the Mexico City rule, where each year, you all know what this is too. On January 21st, we swear in a president. On January 22nd, if it's a Republican, he implements the global gag rule, which means that all money stops from our country to family planning clinics if they so much as mention the word abortion, let alone provide services. I mean, so it really kills clinics. Clinics close all over and women die. Low-income women die. So, and if it's a Democratic president, Barack Obama, he removes it the next time. So so women are political football in this. So where does the legislation come in? This is an executive action every 8 years, apparently.
Right. Well,
so what are you talking about? I mean, what are you referencing when you say action on the global gag rule? What action?
Oh, no, I mean, it's okay. There's executive orders.
Yeah.
And there's actual legislation.
Right.
That Congress put forward. We have co-sponsored legislation that basically brings back the global gag rule. You see what I'm saying?
And reversing it.
Thank you.
And you have Republican supporters.
I didn't say that. But once again, we're sending a message, basically letting them know that, you know, this is where we stand. We're setting down this marker, and hopefully, come 2018, if we take back the House, if we take back the Senate, and then 2020, if we have a Democratic president, that will get signed.
Right, well, that would be a good thing. So this is our task to take back to Congress next
time. I think we have time for maybe two more questions. Yeah. Anybody else who hasn't had a chance for a question? Start with the young lady.
Oh, so she was picked first.
No, but she had a question.
Okay, well, I have a list, but we're not going to go into this. We'll talk about it. I was talking to a bioresearch person who works for Driscoll and their organic strawberry division. And so we were talking about Driscoll does primarily organic strawberries here in Santa Cruz County, and they use organic pesticides. She actually told me that the organic pesticides that they use are more harmful than the non-organic pesticides because they don't break down the same way that the other ones do. And I just looked at her, my mouth dropped, and she said, yeah, it's that bad. And she actually personally is working on more organic pests, working with pests that are that organic. And I was floored, absolutely floored. I had no idea that this was going on in our organic growing agricultural lands. And I would have liked Anna to stay so that she could have chirped in on this. But how do we deal with it? I mean, it's like linseed oil. Linseed oil is it's organic, but it's very detrimental to us. These organic pesticides don't break down. They go into our soil and they stay forever.
So
how do we deal with this? How do we move forward? And that's just a piece of information that just totally freaked me out. I'm sorry.
Yes, sir. I can't speak to what Driscoll's does. I don't know. All I know about what the story you just told me. Obviously, you know, with the last comment of that lady that was here talking about that. I'm sorry, I forgot her name. The doctor.
López.
You know, thank you. Yeah, you know, she basically said we need to move to organic farming. Obviously, those types of pesticides that are harmful need to be regulated, which the state of California does a good job doing, I believe. Could be, you know, they're looking at them, they're testing things. I just had an hour-long meeting about
You almost got it.
You know what
you're doing good.
Chlorpyrifos.
Yes.
Chlorpyrifos.
Chlorpyrifos. Thank you. Never did that. These are issues that need to be researched. But in the meantime, I believe that, you know, organic farming is something that needs to be supported. And that's what I've done in Congress.
Right.
I've co-sponsored two bipartisan bills that have contributed over $50 billion to organic farming. Because we think that's important. And they are basically, what's happened is that the Ag Committee, because of my efforts on the Ag Committee and my kind of pushing them, have taken some of that funding, a desired funding from our bill, and put it into the Farm Bill. And hopefully that will lead to research and development, especially to dealing with something as dangerous like this, at least that's what she's saying.
Yes.
So that basically we can deal with preventing that, stopping that, and coming up with other ways to help our organic crops.
Right. So there's currently 46 units of affordable housing being built in Pottsville, which is great. But it wouldn't have been possible if Pottsville did not have the special designation that makes it rural, this rural status. And that's both in Pottsville and Salinas that are the two grandfathered areas that are still within this like rural designation that can go away like any minute, rather than if it's, I don't know how it works out really well. So how do you protect these two communities that have a very large farm worker workforce to continue to get this farm worker housing money?
Is this farm worker housing money state or federal?
Well, it's federal. It gets the rural designation because of the low income tax rate, which is federal.
Got it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. The designation is, you think a federal, comes down federally?
It's or? Federal. It's dictated by the USDA.
Yeah.
It actually affects transportation as well.
As well.
Sure. If I say that again, the FDA, you said?
USDA.
Exactly. Look, I think starting, I'm actually considering putting forward more legislation that deals with funding of farm worker housing through the USDA. And that would be a way to make sure that, you know, designation, at least if it's there, to make sure that those areas get the necessary funding to build rural housing. As you heard Bill talk about, you know, you have a bunch of farmers in this area who are actually pivoting towards building their own housing in order to deal with the labor issue through an H-2A process. In regards to that designation, I think obviously it's important that we continue to highlight that, make sure it's secure. I have not heard that it's threatened in any way.
I heard that it's if you update the Farm Bill because it lowers the population size and because Salinas and Monty were grandfathered a long time ago, but when you update the Farm Bill, it will get rid of that grandfathering.
I have not heard of that in the 2018 Farm Bill.
Okay.
However, I will look into that, and we will try to ensure that that doesn't happen, because I know what you're saying exactly. We need that designation in order to make sure that they get the appropriate funds to from the USDA to build that site of housing.
Great. So one more question, time for one more. Look,
people, you know, these types of conversations are very important. You're calling my office is very important. When I say calling, not emails, I like the calls. Okay, my staff may not, but I do. Because that, to me, it shows you're willing to pick up the phone and actually talk with somebody on the other line, give your information, be open and honest and transparent about it. And I think that's very important. So feel free to call my office anytime. I have a lot of information coming at me, okay? A lot of stuff coming at me. And the best thing you can do is call me before the vote happens, okay? I had calls after, and they said, why did you do this? I'm like, did you call me before? No, I haven't. Call me before. Let me know your opinions. Let me know your issues. Let me know if we can help you in any way. That's why we're there. And so that would be my one ask of you, to keep up the communication with me so that I can better represent you in Washington.
Thank you for responding to our call.
Of course. Thanks for your letter.
Joining the club. We have membership forms out there, but you do not have to be a member to sign on. Go to our website and sign on to be on our email list so you get meeting notices. You know, we want the public to come. Of course, we want you to join. Next year, we do make endorsements. We are the oldest club and the largest club in the county, and our endorsements are very highly sought after, and you don't get to vote in endorsement meetings unless you're a member 30 days before. And our endorsement meeting will be in late March because the filing closes something like the 7th, I think, 9th, 7th. So probably, I think I would ask for March 31st, please community rooms.
We're going to introduce your aides.
Of course, thank you.
I have them introduce themselves.
Thank you. Yeah, please, go ahead. And tell them what office you work in.
My name is Emmanuel Garcia. I work out of the Santa Cruz office right next to the courthouse, room 318C. My door is always open. And I have business cards if you'd like one. several people in this room, I can see that I recognize that I know, and you can have them, give me your contact information, you'll be able to get your contact me. Yeah, so feel free.
And my name is Manny Jimenez. I'm a little new to this community. I'm actually in the Salinas office, so if you're ever in downtown Salinas, we're in the post office building.
Thank you. Thanks again.
Thank you.